Should we start? There's some space here in the front of you. Very good. Good. So good afternoon, everybody. This is a great day for us. This is the scientific highlight of the year. So I'm very pleased to see the full room, and I'm sure you will enjoy the ceremony. As you all know, we are celebrating the Dirac Medal for 2016. And the Dirac Medal is one of the most prestigious awards that are given to theoretical physicists since 1985. The list of awardees is very impressive, as you can see online, or you can come to close to my office to see all the people who have won it since 1985. Edward Witten and then Samolozhikov got it, and then people like David Gross, Fadejev, Wilczek, Nambu, Veldman, Goldstone, many other famous names. Essentially, every year we have been selecting outstanding scientists, including last year's Nobel Prize winner, Haldane. So it's one of the most prestigious awards given worldwide, and we are very pleased to keep the tradition and keep the standards, having a very high-level committee to select them. And so today we have a great combination of awardees, which we are very proud to have them all here. And so I'm sure you will enjoy the ceremony. So let me say a few words first. So as you can see in the program, I will say a few words first, then Daniele Matti kindly agreed to say some words about each of the awardees because he knows them quite well, both scientifically and as a friend. And then I will have the honor actually to give the award to each of them in alphabetical order, and they will give a presentation. So so let me say some words about each of them before we move on. So, first one is Nathan Seiberg, is Natty. He was born in 1956, 22nd of September in Tel Aviv. So he just turned 60 last year. Nice celebration, well deserved. Mm-hmm. And he has his bachelor degree from Tel Aviv University and a PhD from the Weizmann Institute. And then he moved to the Institute for Advanced Studies for several years. And then he has been building up a great career in science. He had a position in Rutgers University for 9 years or so until he went back to the Institute for Advanced Studies. He also had some period in Weizmann again as a professor. And so he has been for the past 20 years one of the professors in this Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. So Natti is one of the outstanding theoretical physicists worldwide, and I have been very pleased to follow his career since I was a student. I always say that we are the same age, but I see him always up because scientifically he has some years of difference, but also the quality of his science and the discoveries he has made are impressive, and I have been having the pleasure to follow it up for the past 30 years or so. He impressed me for the talent that he has to have extract good questions and come up with good answers for many areas of physics, and that is year by year, and people who are attending the school this week have witnessed the clarity of his thought, and his presentations are outstanding, and so he's one of the role models for many of us to how science should be done and is done. So then the second one is Michael Schiffman. Michel? Michael Schiffman was born on April 4, 1949, in Riga, Latvia. He received his education in Moscow Institute for Physics and Technology, so 1966 to 72. Then from 72, he was admitted to the graduate program at the Institute for Theoretical Physics, as Theoretical and Experimental Physics, ITEP, in Moscow. He received his PhD in 1976. And then he stayed there until departure to the U.S. in 1990, where now he's is a member of the William I. Fine Theoretical Physics Institute at the University of Minnesota, where he is the Ida Cohen Fine Professor of Physics since 1990. He's a world expert in theoretical high-energy physics, from quantum chromodynamics to supersymmetry, instantons, et cetera. He has made major contributions in the field. One of the important things that I will then expand later is his close collaboration with the third winner, which is Arkady Weinstein. And Arkady was born in 1942 in the Siberian city of Novokuznetsk. He attended Novosibirsk State University and completed his master's in 64 and PhD in 68. At the Butker Institute of Nuclear Physics. His interests are in general from his early days have been in concentrated in gauge theories of fundamental interactions, and he's still working on that area and making major contributions. Again, from 1990, he moved to the United States as professor at the University of Minnesota, where he is now the Gloria Lupkin Professor and member of the William I. Fine Theoretical Physics Institute. The three of them have received several awards. In the case of Natti, MacArthur Fellowship, Danny Heinemann Prize, and Fundamental Physics Prize recently. In the case of Misha, the Sakurai Prize, the Julius Edgar Lilienfeld Prize, and the Pomeranchuk Prize. And in the case of Arkady, and also the Pomeranchuk Prize and Sakurai Prize. And so we're very honored to add to the awards that they all deservedly have won, to get now the Dirac Medal. In the case of Misha and Arkady, I can also say that I have been reading some of the essays that you have written in the last few years about your life before and after moving to the United States. And I think it's very inspiring for us, for many people from the developing countries, for instance, to see how they managed to achieve great research, great achievements in conditions which were not ideal for research. So the conditions that I have read that, I mean, when they were supporting each other, a very small group of physicists working together and attracting young students, very competitive, and working day and night until I think the last metro leaves at 1 a.m. or something, and then come with collaborations even by telephone with paying your own bills and so on. So I think it's very inspiring for all of us to see how they have achieved so many things working in not ideal conditions. And I learned, well, today from Arcade that the ICTP was the first place he came. I'm sure you will mention something on it. And so I'm pleased that ICTP has played a role in their careers. But I think, well, they have made together and independently major contributions also to physics. in this case, well, heavy quarks, the famous penguin diagrams before they were called penguin, and instanton supersymmetry, conformative theory, and the exact beta functions, and so on. So I think they, all of the three of them, belong to this prestigious list of awardees of the Dirac Medal that we have had over the years. So let me read the official statement about the medal today. The ICTP's 2016 Dirac Medal and Prize are awarded to Nathan Cyber from the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton, Michael Schiffman from the University of Minnesota, and Arkady Weinstein from the University of Minnesota for their important contributions to a better understanding of field theories in the non-perturbative regime, and in particular for exact results in supersymmetric field theories. Professor Cyber has made major contributions to supersymmetric field theories, elucidating the power of holomorphy to establish the non-renormalization theorems, the different phases of n equals 1 supersymmetric theories, and uncovering a strong recoupling duality known as Cyber duality. He, in collaboration with Edward Witten, also made major contributions towards a full non-perturbative understanding of n equals 2 theories that has led to many further developments in theoretical physics and mathematics. Professors Schiffman and Weinstein have collaborated most fruitfully for more than 30 years. Besides their important independent work, they have jointly uncovered several properties of strongly interacting field theories, in particular of quantum chromodynamics with Schiffman, Weinstein, Sakharov, some rules, and the introduction of the gluon condensate. They also made fundamental contributions to the non-perturbative studies of supersymmetric gauge theories, clarifying the relation between the one-particle reducible and Wilsonian effective actions, and culminating with the proposal for the Novikov, Schiffman, Weinstein, Sakharov exact beta functions. The selection committee this year was composed of Professors Michael Green, David Gross, Bertrand Halperin, Giorgio Parisi, Joseph Polchinski, Martin Rees, and Ashok Sen. So that concludes this part of the ceremony. And I will now ask Daniele to come here and say some words about the three awardees.
Well, it's a great honor for me to have been invited to introduce these three excellent colleagues, great physicists, winner of the medal that has such an importance in our field. Therefore, I am really honored to be able to say two words, only two words, about them. So, one of the advantages of the old age I have is that I have seen them growing up. Well, therefore, I am a friend of them since many years, and I have seen their brilliant career to develop over already a quarter of a century, nearly. Well, let me start with Michael and Arkady, that they were really so strongly associated within me and in the field of physics. I met them at ITEP when they were in Moscow, where they were forming a group together with Sakharov and also other colleagues that was very tightly bound, very active, and working in as I was saying, Fernando, in a condition that were hard, but in some senses, I believe that they were really excellent. The conditions were really excellent in the sense that physics was a very fundamental thing for them. The atmosphere at this institute, as ITEP, was really very, very lively. The discussions were enormous. Seminars were lasting hours. And it was a fantastic climate. I am not so sure that we can reproduce easily this climate nowadays. Well, when I met them, they were mainly working in some rules, it was the year 60s, on some rules that were used for strong interactions, mainly for strong interactions. Then they moved to supersymmetric theories as introducing some specific things as non-perturbative instantons situations, and the exact results that were possible to obtain in supersymmetric field theory, gauge theories. Then this strong feeling among them were successfully transferred when they immigrated to the United States, and then they created in Minnesota this famous Russian group that that conquered the Midwest North Side. So, about Nati, let's say his very deep scientific vision, with his fantastic drive that he succeeded to keep on and on since years, and his pretty strong character, which is very pretty unique. In physics, he contributed in many, many fields, and his presence, the presence of his fingerprint, is there practically in all developments of the theoretical aspects of fundamental theoretical physics in the last 20 years. He explored supersymmetric field theories, string theories, emphasizing the different roles, for instance, the role of microscopic studies, wall sheet studies, with macroscopic results, space-time, let's put it that, properties, that appear in superpotential, and characteristic of the superpotential, their dependence on many things as Guarino condensation, instanton, and so on. He's organizing tools, as he names them, the organizing tools that were strongly dependent on supersymmetry, included then many outcomes, topological, conformal properties, the important role of holomorphy, dualities, all landmarks of our present theoretical understanding. I will not go deeper into the presentation of these three brilliant colleagues. Let me say a couple of words more. They have worked in a very fundamental way in the last 20 years or half a quarter of a century, and this they appear after after the big success that coherence implied in field theoretical attempts to produce our understanding of particle physics, what is called the standard model, and the important subsequent experimental verification of the standard model. Despite the fact that it was a perturbative attitude, this means expressed in a Lagrangian, if you want, this implied fundamental abstract concepts that implied really new paradigms in physics. This means that was a theory based on non-observable basic fields, quarks, gluons, in a situation in which there is a non-observable symmetry, because the gauge theory, the gauge symmetry, which is crucially in all these, is broken spontaneously. This is really a big change, a paradigmatic change with respect to our to how we were working before, and mainly represented, for instance, QED, where electrons and photons were having their fields, and these were the fields that were observed and present in the theory. This fact that the physicists arrived, this was before their coming in, that physicists arrived to these concepts was really again blown by a wind of coherence, of theoretical coherence, that was not directly obtained from phenomenology. The coherence was imposed, if you want, on the and then the phenomenology appeared as coming out from this coherence. This change of paradigm is a very important thing, and is proved correct, so correct that not only the perturbative approach was checked, but also quantum effect. This means higher order effects were actually measured, and the big success of the theory. This really is a glorious success of abstraction of the human mind. The human mind, based on some requirements of coherency and meaningful arguments, gave rise to this very important success. So this feeling of success of abstraction went on in trying to refine the theory, and there is where they appear, if you want the physics in this last quarter of the century, trying to extend the realm to non-perturbative effects, things that may come in and violate, or say, be new with respect to our perturbative understanding. The bulk of novel tools that these works produced is impressive. Supersymmetry, string theory, duality, not only the duality that relates strong to weak, strong and weak couplings, but many kinds of dualities. The strong and weak coupling is one of the things that were first, indeed, strongly suggested by Natti, which is, for instance, the electric-magnetic duality. And others, there are many things, as non-local structures, brains, and so on. So there are a bulk of things that came out in this quarter of a year. Now, it's true that this implies a certain feeling of the clash, if you want, of the feeling of omnipotence, that of the abstract power of human mind, mathematical and abstract power of human mind, and the impotence, instead, to extend quickly the exploration of nature in such a way to understand how these concepts can be applied. I, for instance, a few days ago, it was said that at the Morion conference, they asked what was announced at the Morion conference, and I have been told nothing new. You see, therefore, there is this feeling of frustration of having an enormous quantity of new concepts and not being able to see where to apply them. And this is a real feeling that strongly. Now, I am confident, nonetheless, of the propulsive nature of human mind. And therefore, I would advise young people, young physicists, as the majority of you are here, to continue exploring with the strength and drive that these three colleagues have shown in the last quarter of a century, keeping an eye, perhaps, on recognizing new corners where this new idea could apply and be important. True, for instance, that these ideas are not only now perhaps relevant to particle physics, but also to cosmology, to the structure of the universe, and so on. There can be corners in which these new ideas can fruitful. Now, remember always that our field represents the ultimate frontier between elementarity, fundamentality, and human nature. And nature, not human nature, nature. Therefore, this is a field whose frontier can be hard to to watch. However, it's a field that proved to be very fertile, and I'm convinced that with the effort of intelligent minds will continue to give a lot of results. Thank you anyhow to these three people that gave up.
Thank you very much, then, Daniel, for such an inspiring talk. So now I will proceed to go one by one. The procedure that we will award the medal to each of the awardees by alphabetical order, and then the corresponding awardee will give his own presentation. Then we repeat the same twice. So it will be a very simple thing. So I hope we all know what we're going to do. So now it's a pleasure and a real honor to call Nati Seibert so that we can give him the award for the Dirac Medal.
And an honor.
But then we'll ask Nati to give his presentation. Probably the other members of the table, if you want, probably we can sit here to follow the slides.
Can follow here.
You can follow there? Okay, perfect.
This generous introduction. I was kind of embarrassed to sit here to hear all these things. I feel enormously honored and humbled to receive the Dirac Medal and to be here together with Misha and Arkady. It's a great honor for me. Over the years, I've benefited from a lot of interactions with many mentors. It's on. Yeah, it's on. Over the years, I've benefited from a lot of interaction with other people. I interacted with mentors who educated me, colleagues, my peers, and I also worked a lot with junior collaborators. And all these people have taught me quite a lot and have contributed fundamental insights to our joint work and even work that I did without them. So the work that is being recognized here today was done really in collaboration with a lot of people, and I feel that the award is really to all of them. I've come to the ICTP many times as a speaker. I wasn't here as a student. I think today's the first time I was here was about 30 years ago. And I feel that the ICTP is doing a fundamentally important, tremendously important work here, influencing lots and lots of young people all over the world. So last time I was here was 3 years ago. I gave a talk. I gave a series of talks in the spring school, and they asked me to give a colloquium. And after the colloquium, I met with a group of students here from the diploma program. And this is the group. And this meeting was enormously inspiring for me. It was really moving. You can see many faces here. Just by looking at that, you can see that it looks like the map of the world. There were people here from the Congo, from North Korea, from South America, from all over the world. And it was really, and I think one, at least one of them is here in the audience today. Two of them are in the audience today. And I think this is a statement about the success of ICTP and its impact on people. And it was really inspiring to see young people coming from all over the world, literally from all over the world. They came here to study physics, to study science. They were not interested in the political differences, the cultural differences, and so forth. They were just interested in science. And I feel this is an important bridge between different countries, a bridge that will help everybody. It's not a zero-sum game. It's a win-win situation. And I encourage the ICTP to continue doing this wonderful work. You have a fantastic mission. Keep doing it. And I feel that today, this activity is more important than ever. In the current climate, it's even more important to do it. And I'm glad it is in good hands, and I hope you will continue doing this wonderful work. So going to physics, today's talk will have three parts, kind of three chapters, and there will be kind of one after the other, but there will be a lot of cross relations between them. The first I'll talk about symmetries, and then I'll talk about duality, and finally about the unity of physics, trying to give some vision for the future. Most of the work will be a review of old material, so in order not to clutter the slides, I will give no references except on one slide, where I'll summarize all the people who contributed recently during the past 5 years. So, section one, symmetries. Of course, this is the Taj Mahal, a beautiful symmetric structure. People have loved symmetries for years. And physicists in particular also like symmetries. And they have used symmetries over the years in many different contexts, going back here by Galileo. This is an appropriate place. And then Lorentz and Poincaré, they were interested in symmetries of space and time. Then it was used in crystallography, symmetries of the lattice. And in the 20th century, there were more subtle symmetries, symmetries that are not easily visible, like flavor symmetry, isospin, SU2 isospin, and then SU3 of Gell-Mann and Neyman that helped eventually lead to the quark model. A more sophisticated symmetry is the gauge, or local symmetry. It first appeared in Maxwell's theory. In fact, Maxwell, in his writing, was fully aware of the gauge symmetry. He formulated his theory in terms of the vector potential, A of x, and the equations were invariant under such a transformation, A mu goes to A mu plus D mu lambda. And the key point here is that this parameter, lambda, can depend on space and time. The same symmetry appeared later in general relativity. This is in Einstein's work. It appears also in Riemannian geometry and then in physics in Einstein's work, where the metric can transform according to coordinate transformations. And again, the key point is that this transformation parameter, xi, can depend on a point in space and time, xi of x. So unlike the ordinary symmetries, the global symmetries that were discussed here, this symmetry is much bigger. We have a separate trimetry transformation for every point in space and time. Such gauge symmetries were later considered to be fundamental building blocks of nature. In fact, the second half of the 20th century was really dominated by gauge symmetries. The standard model of particle physics is based on the gauge group SU3 times SU2 times U1. This is a color SU3, not to be confused with this flavor SU3. And when I went to school, that was in the 70s, I learned that as this is the big thing. Gauge symmetries are deep. First of all, it's a larger symmetry, much bigger than the global symmetry. With the global symmetry, we have a transformation parameter, which is a number. For gauge symmetries, the transformation parameter is a function of space and time. So it's a much bigger symmetry. We have a separate group element in every point in space and time. And it's also extremely powerful, and that's what allows the standard model of particle physics to be consistent, to make the theory both manifestly Lorentz invariant, unitary, and local, and therefore causal. And Daniele, in his inspiring presentation today, alluded to precisely this structure. So that's clearly good and deep and interesting and useful. And it also appeared all over the place. So it looks like these ideas of gauge symmetries are very common. This is a common theme in physics. I've already mentioned that they appear in Maxwell's theory and in the standard model of particle physics. They also appeared in general relativity, extremely powerful and important in many condensed matter systems. and they are related to deep mathematics. These are the hallmarks of a deep idea, of an excellent idea. It's deep, it's fundamental, it's useful, and its implications go far beyond what the originators of the idea planned. When people started discussing, I think the first reference for that is Maxwell's work, when he discussed the gate symmetry, I don't think he could imagine that so much physics could come out of this principle. So the hallmark of a deep idea is that it works better than it is designed to work. There's a problem, you try to solve it, you find a solution, but then the same solution works all over the map. But, this is a big but. It's a big but because when we look more closely, because of Gauss' law, the Hilbert space is really gauge invariant. So this beautiful symmetry that is so enormous and so deep and so powerful doesn't really act on anything. It's a fake symmetry. It's not really there. Now, in classical Maxwell theory, there is indeed no need to use the gate symmetry. And after Maxwell wrote the equations in terms of the vector potential, other people wrote the equations in terms of not just the electric field and the magnetic field. And in fact, this is how Maxwell's equations are taught in high school or in the first course of electrodynamics. So there's really no need to use the gauge symmetry. Of course, in the quantum theory, the vector potential is important, and the associated gauge symmetry is crucial. But again, there's some feeling that this is a strange thing. On one hand, we have this enormous symmetry, and on the other hand, it doesn't act on anything. So it's fair to say that the gauge symmetry is not a symmetry. It's not really a symmetry in the standard sense. It doesn't act on anything. All the operators are gauge invariant. So what are we really doing here? How can it be that something that on one hand looks so deep and on the other hand looks totally irrelevant? How can that be? So a better phrase to use here is not a gauge symmetry because it's not a symmetry, but a gauge redundancy. This is a redundant description that we have. And having this redundancy is extremely powerful, extremely useful, but we cannot possibly say that this is a symmetry, and I don't see why this could be so deep. So this is what I wanted to say about symmetries. Let's put that aside for a while, and we'll come back to that later. And we are moving to section two of the talk, duality. So there are lots of examples of duality. The first of them appears already in Maxwell's theory. Maxwell already realized that if you look at Maxwell's equations in the vacuum, there are no sources, and you can exchange the electric and the magnetic field, the equations remain the same. So he already noticed that. And it's really easy to establish that. In 2 plus 1 dimensions, a scalar field, phi, is dual to the field strength. So whenever you have just electrodynamics, instead of discussing the field strength, you can discuss a scalar field using such a transformation. And the transformation from the vector potential and phi is a non-local transformation. You need to solve a differential equation. And this equation is actually extremely interesting because the Bianchi identity of the field strength, which is kind of trivial on the left-hand side, is the field equation on the right-hand side. This is the dynamical equation. Whereas the dynamical equation, Maxwell's equation of the left-hand side, is a triviality on the right-hand side. This is, again, one of the hallmarks of duality. There are two different descriptions, and what is easy in one language is complicated in the other language, and vice versa. So I've already mentioned the 3 plus 1 dimensional generalization of this, which exchanges E and B. And again, we have this phenomenon that the field equation on one side becomes the Bianchi identity on the other side, and vice versa. So what looks like a triviality on one side is really where all the dynamics is in the other side of the duality. And again, we see that the theory has two vector potentials, the vector potential that sits here and another vector potential that sits here. And these two vector potentials are related to each other in a very non-local way, in a very complicated non-local way. And the gauge symmetry that this transformation is based on, that this transformation maps from, is emergent. What do I mean by that? We can start with the scalar field theory. It has no gauge symmetry at all, and we manufacture a gauge theory out of it. So the gauge symmetry of this electrodynamics is totally emergent. It's not even there in the fundamental formulation of the theory. Similarly here, even if we insist on using a gauge potential here for this F, it has its gauge symmetry, but by the time we do the duality transformation, we use the other degrees of freedom that sit here, and the vector potential here and the gauge symmetry of the new vector potential have nothing to do with the gauge transformation of the left-hand side. So this theory has two gauge symmetries. Neither of them is really essential. It's nice to have them both, but we can formulate the theory either with one or with the other, but not simultaneously with both. So that's another sign that there's something funny with this. How can we say that it's so deep that we can formulate the theory without ever using it? There's a gauge symmetry that emerges after the description, even though it's not essential to the theory, and in fact, it's not present in the fundamental formulations. Over the years, many more examples of dualities were found. These dualities are much more interesting than the dualities I've presented so far. These are dualities that are more subtle, and they occur in interacting theories. Some of them can be proved exactly, and others are conjectures. So going back in history, Kermit-Vanier duality of the Ising model and its various generalizations are considered to be extremely interesting, very powerful, very deep, and they can be proven exactly. So that's the hallmark of these. And they appear, they even tested experimentally when we examine systems like the Ising model and the high temperature and the low temperature phases are related by Kermit-Vanier duality. And again, the transformation from the original degrees of freedom to the dual degrees of freedom is non-local. And again, the transformation takes weak coupling to strong coupling, takes a complicated problem and rewrites it in terms of weakly coupled, easy to understand degrees of freedom. And then there are many other examples, primarily in 1+1 dimensional field theory, of such dualities. And we can talk, we can give full lectures on them. They are extremely interesting, but I would like to take the talk to higher dimensions where the structure is more interesting. And the ellipses here stand for more and more examples. There are literally thousands and thousands of examples of that. So let me move to 3+1 dimensions. And the example that is kind of the prime example of duality in 3+1 dimensions is the duality of what is known in n equals 4 super Young Mills. So this is a supersymmetric theory. And the details of what I'm going to say now are not important. So if you don't understand, don't bother. But they are really important if you want to have a more detailed understanding of what's going on here. So this theory is scale invariant, and it is characterized by a gauge group G and a coupling constant alpha, like the fine structure constant of electrodynamics. And it turns out that the theory with gauge group G and coupling constant alpha is identical to a theory with a totally different group, I denote it by G tilde, and another coupling constant, which is 1 over alpha. So if we crank alpha to make it bigger and bigger, the interactions become stronger and stronger, and the theory becomes hopelessly complicated. But now, the dual description in terms of G tilde comes to the rescue, and the complicated theory that we don't know how to analyze can be equivalently described using other degrees of freedom that are weakly coupled. And again, we see that this transformation that maps strong coupling to weak coupling, and in quantum mechanics, small fluctuations and large fluctuations. In one case, the quantum mechanical fluctuations are very large and strong, and in the other descriptions, they are weak and hardly fluctuate. And the theory is formulated in terms of gluons, and the gluons, the fundamental gluons, are the gluons of G, are magnetic monopoles of the gluons of G tilde, and the gluons of G tilde are magnetic monopoles of G. So again, we see that the degrees of freedom here are related in a non-local way to the degrees of freedom here. So now we just extract some lessons from that. The gauge symmetry of the dual description is clearly emergent. We had some gauge theory of the original description. We write some Lagrangian, we write some system, and it has its gauge symmetry. But in the dual description, we find a new gauge symmetry, which is completely emergent. So this deep structure of gauge symmetry just comes out of thin air. It wasn't there in the original formulation of the theory. So we can ask ourselves, which of the two gauge symmetries is fundamental? The original one or the one after duality? That's a very interesting question because they cannot both be fundamental because we use only one of them in the description but not the other. Perhaps neither is fundamental, and I think that's actually the right answer. So it cannot be both, and none of them is preferred over the other, so it must be none. We also discussed the gluons that the theory describes. The theory describes some gluons that interact with each other. But we said that there are two sets of gluons, the gluons of the original theory and the gluons of the dual theory. They are not equal. One of them is fundamental, the other is composite, or the other is fundamental and the original one is composite. So which of them is more elementary? Which of them should be used to describe the theory? And again, the answer is neither, because the notion of elementary particle is ill-defined. So what we see here is that traditionally we thought that we have some fundamental degrees of freedom in the system, and we write some Lagrangian or Hamiltonian, and then we solve the system and we find answers. But now we see that this whole way of thinking misses something fundamental. It misses something crucial. It misses the fact that the fundamental degrees of freedom or the elementary particles, this notion is ill-defined. Moving to another notion of duality. So far I discussed this duality in n equals 4 super young Mills or in the Ising model. These are exact dualities. And the new dualities that I'm going to talk about now are two different. So far we had exact dualities with exactly the same physics. But now there will be another notion that the two dual theories just have the same physics at long distances. So this is typical in physics. We have some Hamiltonian or some Lagrangian at short distances that describe some interactions, and that's what we call UV. I couldn't do that in ultraviolet, so I did it in violet. And at long distances, we have an effective Hamiltonian describing the long-distance physics, and that we call infrared. And again, I couldn't do it in infrared, so it's in red. And it typically has different degrees of freedom. In simple situations, the degrees of freedom here are a subset or some clearly related to the degrees of freedom here. But in more interesting situations, the effective degrees of freedom at long distances look like very, very complicated expressions in terms of the microscopic degrees of freedom. And in many cases, many situations, we don't even have an exact map between them. And there are lots of examples of that. There are lots of examples where we have the degrees of freedom at short distances and the degrees of freedom at long distances that we can or cannot relate them in a simple way. One example is the Ginzburg-Landau theory of superconductivity, where there is some scalar field. And more microscopically, this scalar field can be thought of as a pair of electrons. So at short distances, we have electrons, and they interact with phonons, et cetera, et cetera. It's a complicated story. It's a beautiful story. And at long distances, there is an effective description, an infrared description of superconductivity, which historically came first. And this is Ginzburg-Landau theory. Similarly, in QCD, at short distances, we have quarks and gluons. And this is the celebrated success that Daniele discussed in his presentation today. But at long distances, we see just pions. And people in the 60s and 70s were brilliant to figure out all this analysis of the quarks and the gluons by just looking at what happens at long distances and studying the pions, and then eventually get to shorter distances and get deep inelastic scattering and so forth. But sometimes the relation between the microscopic degrees of freedom and the macroscopic degrees of freedom is not so simple. And in all the examples of an emergent gate symmetry, this is the case. In other examples, I wrote examples here from condensed matter physics, particle vortex duality in 2 plus 1 dimensions, and it was nice that today I could give a talk about precisely this topic. And then there's an emergent gate symmetry in the fractional Hall effect, and the list goes on and on. There are lots of examples where the degrees of freedom at long distances are very complicated in terms of the short distance degrees of freedom. So let me give another more elementary example of that. We look at the water here in the Adriatic Sea, and the water at short distances is made out of molecules. There are water molecules there, and they jump around, and they move, and so forth. When we look at long distances, we don't care where each molecule is. Even if we cared, there would be no way that we could deal with that. Instead, the object we are interested in is the shape of the water. So first of all, there's how fast the water moves. There would be some velocity. And second, there would be how high the waves are and how the water moves. The degrees of freedom that describe that are very, very complicated in terms of the fundamental degrees of freedom, which are the coordinates of the molecules, of where every molecule is a function of time. This is the short distance description, and at long distances, the relevant degrees of freedom is the shape of the water, which is related in a very complicated, non-local way to the short distance degrees of freedom. And that's actually common. So this is an example from almost from everyday life. But this phenomenon that the degrees of freedom at long distances are very complicated in terms of the short distance degrees of freedom is very common. So let me give you another example of that, and that is duality in interacting field theories in four dimensions with n equals one supersymmetry. And it comes in two forms. The first, we have two different theories at short distances in the ultraviolet. One of them will be called the electric theory, and the other will be called the magnetic theory. And the gluons here and the gluons here are related in a very non-local way. In fact, we don't know how to relate them. Yet, we know that these are two different theories, and the flow at long distances, the behavior of the system at long distances is the same. This theory and this theory, although being fundamentally different, they flow to exactly the same physics at long distances. The other kind of this duality is such that we start at short distances with a theory which we will call electric, based on some gauge group G, and there are some quarks, et cetera, et cetera. There's some interactions, and this is very complicated. And as the interaction becomes stronger and stronger, we end up at long distances with an approximately free theory based on some other gluons that are composite of that. This situation is extremely interesting. It's extremely interesting because whenever in duality we have something complicated at short distances and a simple answer, simple, almost free theory, at long distances, the answer at long distances, or if you wish, the infrared behavior here, this theory that we find here in the infrared, is really the answer to what we have. At short distances, we see the question. That's kind of, we put electrons in a box, and we shake it, and we compress it, and we heat it, and what have you. And at long distances, we say, ah, this is a superconductor, or it's a semiconductor, or it's an insulator, or whatever other phase we want. So this is the answer, this is the question. And when the theory here is approximately free, we know exactly what the answer is. So this situation is very satisfying. So at short distances, we have an asymptotically free theory based on G, and at long distances, we have an infrared theory based on G tilde. And unlike ordinary QCD that we know about, the theory at long distances is based on a totally different gauge group. And again, the gauge fields that we see at long distances are composite of the short distance degrees of freedom. So we can have gauge symmetry that was not there at short distances, it emerges at long distances, and the corresponding gauge fields, or the gluons, are composite of them. We say that the gauge symmetry is emergent, and what has been done since then is to find tons and tons of examples of that. This phenomenon is quite generic, it's ubiquitous, there are many, many examples, and that's actually the norm. So such a phenomenon of an emergent gauge symmetry and composite gauge fields and composite gluons happens all over the place. So this is section two of the talk. Section one was symmetries. Section two was duality. And now I would like to talk a little bit about other dualities in the unity of physics. I will not mention, because this would be a topic for a totally separate talk, all sorts of dualities associated with gravity, either one theory of gravity dual to another theory of gravity. This comes under the name of string-string duality, or dualities between string theory and field theory, which are called gauge gravity duality or ADS-CFT. These are huge topics that I'm not going to touch on. And the key point that the only thing I would like to take from that is that the same ideas of duality that appear in field theory, the same ideas of duality that relate strong-weak coupling phenomena like in the Ising model or in N equals 4 super Young Mills and in other cases, similar ideas can be extended even to a case of gravity. So I would like to say a few words about a specific example of new dualities that have been discussed recently, and they lead to an interesting philosophical / sociological statement about physics. So let's talk a little bit about bosonization in 1 plus 1 dimensions. So in 1 plus 1 dimensions, one space, one time, it is known that the theory of fermions can be equivalent to a theory of bosons. That shouldn't be surprising, because bosons have integer spin, fermions have half-integer spin, but in 1 plus 1 dimensions, we don't really have spin. So if we don't really have spin, we shouldn't be surprised that we can take something that has spin 0 and write it in terms of something that has spin 1/2, because we don't really have spin in the end of the day. If you wish, if you take a massive particle or a massless, the fields can have spin, but the particles cannot have spin. Because this is a particle sitting there in 1 plus 1 dimension, you cannot rotate. There's nothing to rotate around because space is so degenerate. So there are lots of examples of such bosonization in 1 plus 1 dimensions. 2 plus 1 dimensions is a little bit more interesting, because in 2 plus 1 dimensions, a massive particle can be rotated in the plane. And there have been examples going several decades back of duality of what is known as spin and statistical transmutation of particles. We can have a massive particle in 2 plus 1 dimensions coupled to some gauge fields, and they have some interaction. Doesn't matter what they are. There are some Chern-Simons couplings. And even though the fundamental particle is a boson, it behaves effectively like a fermion. Even though it fundamentally has spin 0, it behaves effectively like a particle which has spin 1/2. And that has been enormously useful and enormously successful in the context of the fractional quantum Hall effect, and this phenomenon comes under the names of flux attachment. It's limited, though, to massive particles, very heavy particles. So it's one very massive particle, not quantum mechanical particle. It's almost semi-classical, kind of one particle attached to some flux. And that has been very powerful. So over the last several years, there's been enormous progress. This is the only slide with references. And you will soon see why there are so many references here. It came because the ideas for that came from different directions, from different lines of investigation. One name is highlighted, Aoni, because he did a big part of this work. And what I'm going to do now is give you a lightning review of this recent phenomena. And we can basically put that in two different kinds, very similar to the two different kinds that I presented earlier in 3 plus 1 dimensions with n equals 1 supersymmetry. So there are lots of examples relating theories of fermions to theories of bosons. The first kind is that we have some fermions interacting with gauge fields. And here is another theory at short distances, a theory of bosons interacting with gauge fields. So both theories are complicated. They both flow to the infrared, and they both flow to the same fixed point at long distances. In fact, it was easy for me because I just did copy and paste of the previous slide that I presented earlier. And the second thing was, again, could be done using copy and paste. We have a theory of bosons and some gauge fields at short distances. And this theory of bosons and gauge fields flows at long distances to free fermions. And the same thing I said before is still true. At short distances, we read off the question. At long distances, we read off the answer. And this is satisfying because here is a complicated question, and here is a simple answer. So this duality gives us a simple answer. What's surprising here is that we start with a theory that doesn't have any fermions. All the elementary degrees of freedom are bosons, and they interact in a complicated way. And at long distances, we see one free fermion. So the fact that they are fermions appears as a quantum phenomenon at long distances, even though we did not put it in by hand. So where did this idea come from? And that, I think, is one of the most beautiful aspects of this story, because it came as a convergence of three totally independent, logically independent lines of investigation. Line of investigations of people who did not even know about the existence of the other line of investigations. So the first of them came from the study of particle vortex dualities. This was done by high energy physicists and condensed matter physicists in the 70s and then pursued through the 80s. Then a totally different line of investigation started in 3 plus 1 dimensions, studying dualities in supersymmetric theories in 3 plus 1 dimensions. And as one of the people who worked on the subject at the time and contributed a little bit to this, I can testify that I had not even known at the time about particle vortex duality. And this has been a very interesting topic. I think Misha might talk more about it. And all these dualities were subjected to many powerful tests that using the powerful tools of supersymmetry, these dualities could be tested. There is no doubt that they are right, and there are lots of examples of that. Then there is a third line of investigation that started from string duality, was motivated a little bit from the supersymmetric dualities, the dualities in string theory, and it turns out that these two are related to each other. And the third line of investigation came from studying ADS-CFT. This is this duality between gauge theories and a theory of gravity. And people found examples of the same bulk theory that is dual to two different boundary theories. So if you didn't understand that sentence, it doesn't matter. The point is that ADS-CFT suggests duality between distinct quantum field theories. If you have the same gravity theory dual to two different field theories, you can just throw away the gravity theory and just have a duality between the two different field theories. And once you have such a duality, it works at large n, and there can be extra checks that can be performed at large n. And if you don't know what n is, it doesn't matter. And finally, there were some suggestions in condensed matter physics using some phase transitions that they observed experimentally or theoretically. So these were the motivations. And the fact that these ideas, which are all conjectural, came together logically independent from three basic lines of investigations, perhaps even more, with people who conjectured the same thing without even knowing that the same conjecture was put forward by other people who were motivated by different things, that sounds like it must be right. Because even though it's not a proof, the fact that two people who think about different ideas motivated by different things, come up with the same suggestions, gives us more, it's a sociological evidence that this is right. It also means that physicists in different branches of physics will interact more with one another. So maybe they should know what the others are doing. And it's also a statement for the funding agencies who try to put us in boxes. Say, oh, you do this kind of physics, but we find that kind of physics. That's not the case. There's only one big physics, and these are different people working and jumping from one to another, and there's a lot of cross-fertilization between them. So there are lots of checks and relations between these dualities. First, we can use these dualities to derive well-established dualities. This is an assumption, but if we make this assumption, we can derive a lot of things that we know are true. There's also relation between the dualities and lots of checks between them. For example, if we assume one of them, we can derive others, and this is a very rich set of dualities. It's also connected to deep ideas in mathematics, which seem like it's unrelated to this story. I'll just mention the names here, mirror symmetry and level rank duality. And again, remember this statement I made earlier in the talk. When you have something that's supposed to solve one problem, but it actually solves other problems that you didn't even attempt to solve, and you didn't even think that it would solve, that's a sign that this is something deep, because you just stumbled on something that is very powerful. And that's an example of that. You do something in physics, and it's related to mirror symmetry or level rank duality. And as I said before, the dualities are not independent. They are part of a very rich set of dualities, and there are this web of dualities. And finally, it has applications to condensed matter physics. So let me just list them. It's related to the fractional quantum Hall effect, physics of the first Landau level at half filling, has exhibit various interesting phenomena, and to gap phases of topological insulators and topological superconductors, and I believe that there would be others. So my time is almost up, so let me conclude. What did we talk about? We talked about symmetries. We said that symmetries are a good organizing principle. They occur in physics. But global symmetries are deep and fundamental, and they help us. Gauge symmetries appear to be emergent and therefore less significant. We also talked about dualities. They're also common in physics. This is the case when there are two different descriptions of the same physics. And one obvious lesson from that is that gauge symmetry that appeared in the first part of the talk cannot possibly be fundamental because it can come and go. We can start with a system without it and it comes in. Or we can start with a system which has one gauge symmetry, that symmetry goes away, and instead we get another gauge symmetry. And finally, we talked about the unity of physics, and we gave these examples how insights from different branches of physics recently converged in 2 plus 1 dimensions, and they have led to better understanding and new phenomena that can be found here. And again, I would like to emphasize that I think this is perhaps the most interesting and useful lesson from here, that there's only one physics. There are different people doing it in cosmology or doing it in high-energy physics or for LHC physics or for condensed matter physics. In the end, the same deep ideas occur everywhere, and we should not try and divide. We should put everybody together. And I think this is in the spirit of the ICTP. There are different peoples coming from different nations with different cultures, but we are all people, and we should all help each other and live happily together. Thank you.
It's a great, great talk, as expected from you. So I really enjoyed it. And we have time for some questions, people in the audience. Yes?
Is it possible to experimentally test this new proposed duality between boson?
Some of them can be, but in condensed matter physics. But I don't know much condensed matter, and I definitely don't know much about the experiment, so I cannot make predictions. And it might take a long time to do it because it might be subtle phenomena. But knowing that these exist, I think, will simplify a lot. The way this thing was motivated from condensed matter physics, it was really motivated to some extent by experimental results, especially particle hole symmetry at the first Landau level at half filling. And if you come to my talk tomorrow, you will hear more about it.
More questions? Okay, so let me ask some questions myself. So you say that gauge symmetries are not real symmetries, are redundancies. On the other hand, we have global symmetries. Gravity doesn't like global symmetries, at least continuous. So what should we conclude about symmetries in this case?
Well, that's a very deep question. I don't know the answer. And I feel that the fact that we don't know the answer is telling us that there's something very, very basic that we're not understanding. And I've said that before more than once. As much as we have learned quantum field theory in the last several decades, our understanding is not just incomplete. I think we miss big parts of the story. And my feeling is that perhaps quantum field theory needs to be reformulated. We shouldn't be surprised by all these dualities. These dualities are extremely surprising. They go against whatever people who, if you took just kind of standard quantum field theory course, that's totally orthogonal. That you shouldn't expect such a thing. And whenever in science there's a result that you're surprised by, it means that you're not thinking about it right. Because once you think about something right, you're not surprised by the results. So the lesson from that, I think, is that there's something basic we're not understanding. Perhaps the whole thing needs to be reformulated. It's not that what our understanding of quantum field theory is wrong. It's not that it's wrong, but it's incomplete, and it needs to be understood better. And there are lots of young people in the audience. This is the challenge. You should view that as a challenge, as an opportunity. There are big questions. We don't understand the questions. There are a lot of hints. And all we need is thinking hard about the hints. And maybe one young, bright person here will just have the answer. That would be great.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Nati. Congratulations again for the well-deserved medal. Okay, so we can continue now with the ceremony. I will be very pleased once you finish with the computer to call Professor Michael Schiffman, and we can give him the Dirac medal. It's a real honor for me to give the medal to you.
Thank you.
Can you hear me? Yes. Okay. Well, I will start my talk with a few words of gratitude. First of all, I want to say thank you to Professor Quevedo for awarding me with such a prestigious, very honorable prize, one of the highest a theoretical physicist can ever receive. Then I want to say thank you to other recipients. Arkady Weinstein, in a sense, was my informal teacher. Most of what I learned when I was a graduate student and at postdoctoral stage, I learned from him. As for Nati, he appeared in theoretical physics as a meteor. You know, at least from our perspective, we lived on a very isolated island, so we didn't know any prehistory, where he comes from, where he was educated, and all of a sudden, from a young person, some very extremely insightful and breakthrough papers started appearing, and I was reading them. I should say that in our institute library, most of them were stolen before I could even read them, so which says a lot. And finally, I find a very brief remark concerning to what Daniela said about our conditions. Indeed, I wrote an article about how we were doing science in our isolated institute, and I called our institute a refuge from the insanity of the outside world, which is exactly what I think characterizes it well. And because it was a refuge, we used to spend there all our time. Sometimes we would leave institute at 10 o'clock in the evening, sometimes towards midnight. We were living, literally living there. And the final, my thank you goes to this audience. I see so many young people in the audience, and beyond any doubt, this is our future. So I feel very happy to see our future sitting right in front of us. Now to my presentation. It will be a little bit historical. And then the second largest part will be more factual. It will be more technical, but I will try to avoid sort of slide over technicalities without putting too much effort in them. I will start with a common knowledge that our today's understanding of nature, which is quite deep, is based on quantum field theory, which next year will celebrate its 90th birthday, so it's pretty an old field of science. Lots have been achieved, but to my mind and from my perspective, the most achievement and complete revolution in quantum field theory came in the last 50 or 40 years. I don't like revolutions, so understand it in quotation marks. I should probably say breakthrough and a change in understanding. This change of understanding is related to two major discoveries. One, the discovery of Young-Mills theories back in 1954. Lots of known about it. And the second is discovery of supersymmetry in four-dimensional, in particular in four-dimensional gauge theories, not necessarily Young-Mills. And the first such theory, I remember a seminar where it was presented first. It was in November 1970 in ETEP, in our institute. And you see here two people who were responsible for this discovery. It's Yuri Golfand and Eugene Lichtman, his graduate students. Well, some people, of course, know of his, of their results, and most of theorists believe that they are responsible for basic super algebra, discovering supercharges. Very few theorists, I know it from my experience, know that they also discovered what is nowadays called supersymmetric quantum electrodynamics. So indeed, it was the first supersymmetric gauge theories. At that time, I was not even a graduate student, so I understood very little, but I remember this event. So here's a page from their work, and you can, indeed, what is written here is the Lagrangian of super QED with, as we would now say, two chiral superfields, Q and Q tilde. They considered not only massless photon, but a massive one. So I crossed these massive terms out, and in the last line there are a couple of typos, but if you discard this, correct these typos, you end open a text on supersymmetry, any text on supersymmetry and compare, you will find that this model is the same what is written in any modern textbooks. So I will start my brief review of physical essence with the statement that supersymmetry changed quantum field theory at its deepest level, and I believe it changed forever. Great, breakthrough results were obtained very early. By the way, I forgot to say that Natty's talk and the subsequent Arkady talks will help me, because some of the elements which belong to the line of ideas I'm going to discuss were already discussed by Natty and will be discussed by Arkady. The first great discovery, I believe, which was made as the vacuum, was that the vacuum did, and the first non-randomization theorem was the discovery of the vanishing vacuum energy density and vacuum energy in supersymmetric field theories. All these problems with torture field theory community from its appearance in late 1920s until 1970s with the divergences in vacuum energy. All of a sudden they disappeared. This remark, by the way, that vacuum energy vanishes was done already in Lichtman's work in 1971. It's present there. And then the second discovery in this direction, which happened soon after Wes and Zumino joined this privileged club, is that superpotentials are also not renormalized in supersymmetric gauge theories. So that was in 70s, and then as we know, in 70s, a minimal supersymmetric standard model was developed by some people, Pierre Fayet, and in part Savas Dimopoulos were responsible for that. And at that time, it was believed that this is the future of particle phenomenology. Now we are more doubtful about that, but still. And there was enormous amount of papers on this in the 1970s. But nobody really tried to start studying supersymmetry at strong coupling in the non-perturbative regime. Believe it or not, it's hard to believe, but the first paper on non-perturbative effects in supersymmetry was published by these three authors, Affleck, Harvey, and Witten, and it appeared in summer of 1982, and it referred to a three-dimensional gauge field theory. At that time, Arkady, myself, and our co-authors were working in full swing on non-perturbative instanton-based effects in supersymmetry, but for a year probably already, and we're quite desperate because nothing. Now it seems absolutely trivial how we couldn't find the answer like that, because it's a very obvious answer, but at that time we were desperate, almost mad, because the right answer wouldn't come. And there were lots of paradox with supersymmetric instantons. Finally, the positive outcome and the solution to the problem how to make compatible instanton calculus with the supersymmetry came in probably late 82. The paper was published in 83. And because this was an easy exercise, it turned out that making them compatible, it requires a rather rigid solution to several problems. In particular, as a byproduct of this compatibility, we found out that the exact beta function in super young Mills theories, So, turned out that the beta function which governs the running of the gauge coupling in any pure supersymmetric Young-Mills theory, with minimal or extended supersymmetry, it has an absolutely geometric nature because you see the first coefficient depends on two integers, the number of bosonic and fermionic zero modes, which are integers. And then it has a geometric progression, which also sums in a simple denominator, which depends on two integers. And you can see that this formula describes all three cases. For minimal supersymmetry, an F is equal to NB over 2. And then B is equal to what, 3, no, 4n. Yes, 4n. So this is 3n. Now for extended supersymmetry, and B is equal to nf, so this denominator is canceled. You have one loop beta function, and for n equal 4 supersymmetry, you see that nb is equal to nf over 2. The first coefficient vanishes and the entire beta function vanishes, so it's a conformal field theory. So this result comes from the fact that instanton background still preserves a part of the supersymmetry, although it breaks another part. And in such cases, and we will see many other examples of such cases, the instanton measure is protected. You calculate it classically, plus you add zero modes if they exist, and that's the complete and exact result. So the next step was going to the supersymmetric gauge theories with matter, and here is a formula which we obtained shortly. It is valid for any supersymmetric theory with any matter content, and you see the matter content only shows up in the numerator. It shows up through the Dinkin indices of various representations of matter superfields, which are, of course, all tabulated. The denominator stays the same. For SUN, this T of G is equal to N. So here we have 3n and then some factor which consists of integers, and these are the anomalous dimensions of the matter fields, which are independent. You have to calculate them. They are not protected by supersymmetry, so they have to be calculated in some manner. We don't know how to get the exact results for them, but the relation between the gauge coupling running and the anomalous equations is absolutely exact. And I should say that this relation has many applications. One of them was the application in Zeidberg's duality in n equal 1 theories. It allows one to obtain both edges of the conformal window. Inside the window, one conformal theory and the other one, which is dual, they run to one and the same theory in the infrared. So it's a useful formula. It also is used in many other, in some other aspects of the supersymmetric Young-Mills theories. Now I will say what I said previously is very well known and used in the literature. I will say a few words about some later developments which I did with mostly with my student, a very Chinese girl, Xiao Yi, because they are less known, but they are kind of very interesting because they refer to the two-dimensional sigma model. It is known from a long time that two-dimensional sigma model is a great laboratory for Young-Mills theories. I in particular learned this statement when I was still undergraduate student from Polyakov, who happened to be my neighbor, and he was telling me the stories about how great is CPN models, how great they are in modeling Young-Mills theories. So here's another example. You see, it's a so-called heterotic or chiral CP model, which has only left-handed fermions, but all right-handed fermions are dropped. So this is the so-called minimal model. And it exists only as CP1 because CP2, CP3, and higher CPs are plagued by some global anomaly, and these theories with chiral fermions would be non-existent. But in CP1 it exists, and if you look at it, it is in fact exactly the similar beta function that appears in n equal 1 super Young-Mills. So it turns out that n equal 1 super Young-Mills is mimicked not by non-chiral, but rather by chiral CP1 model. Now, you can also extend CP1. Model and add an arbitrary number of left-handed spinners, then it also be 0,2 theory, like here. If you add only one left-handed spinner, then you see this the numerator and denominator cancel, and you get the standard one-loop beta function because this symmetry has extended supersymmetry. But if an f is larger than one, you get a different beta function with numerator and numerator. You can play with the parameter nf, and then you can discover the so-called Banks-Zaks phenomena and the conformal window, just the one which had been previously discovered in n equal 1 super Young-Mills. So it is present in this theory too, and you can further play. I don't know, though, whether one can find dual theories near the edge of the conformal window. It should be interesting. Oop. Okay. Now a couple of words. I'm doing with time, or I'm doing not so good. A couple of words of, so far I was speaking about non-minimal model. In fact, working with the non-abelian string vortex strings, of which I will say a little bit later, in non-abelian theories, we discovered a new type of non-minimal CP models, which exists for any n. In fact, it's not exactly CPn because it has an extra fermion which belongs, its target space is C1. Somewhere it is written here. If you add it, you spoil 2,2 supersymmetry, you get 0,2, so it's also a chiral model. It's very interesting chiral model. As I said, it cannot be obtained at any n, so you can play in the large n solution. But again, much in the same time as an n equal 1 super Young Mills with matter fields, you can obtain the exact beta function, and here you see the structure is the same, a numerator and denominator. This model was barely studied in the literature, and it was not known before to mathematicians, so it should come in the future. Well, a few more development of the late 80s, because I really want to focus on the 90s and recent time, was the calculation of the gluina condensate. First, we did it through instanton calculus at strong coupling. Then, to this end, say for SU2, we calculated the correlation function of two gluina operators. Each operator is lambda squared. I should say that this operator plays an important role. In particular, if you want to break supersymmetry, you would just add softly. You would just add the mass term to this lambda-lambda, then you create the gluina mass term, and you can keep it small for at first and see what you still have calculational abilities, so you can figure out what happens if supersymmetry breaking is small and your theory is non-supersymmetric, so it's also a great laboratory. And then I believe we discovered, in doing this calculation, we discovered we were the first to write, correct me please, maybe Natia can correct me if I'm wrong, that the endpoint functions of operators which are Q-closed, such as lambda squared is Q-closed, while their spatial derivatives are Q-exact, that is to say a spatial derivative of lambda squared can be obtained as a commutator of supercharge with something. These super functions are independent of the variable x in this particular case, in fact, of all variables which can exist in the endpoint function. And therefore, if you calculate it, and it turns out to be non-vanishing, it can only be zero, which indicates through the cluster decomposition the existence of the condensate. There is an interesting problem here, which I won't mention due to the lack of time. Later on, Arkady and I, we did this calculation at weak coupling through Higgs and subsequent holomorphy. We find functionally the same result. You see this would be square root of this. It's plus or minus lambda cube. The coefficient here and here turned out different. And why it is different, it is not known till this day. But what was important in this second calculation, when the theory was fully regularized for Higgsing, we discovered unexpectedly that the result for the gluina condensate, normally it would be saturated, the integral would be saturated at instanton sizes of order 1 over the vacuum expectation value of the Higgs field, and that's what a normal person would say a priori, and we thought this a priori too. It turned out that the result could be expressed in terms of a delta function saturated at zero size instanton. So that was the first ever physical example of localization. Okay, in the 1990s, we expanded our area of research. In particular, we did some interesting things in the anomalies and supersymmetric gauge theories. You see, many supersymmetric gauge theories have these central charges, normally a protected quantity, which doesn't receive any corrections. However, it turned out that all in this protection theorem, there are sometimes loopholes due to infrared effect. In particular, in two-dimensional, in the simplest N1,1 theory, in two dimensions, which would present the simplest possible kink ever, there is anomaly which went unnoticed for 15 or 20 years. There are a huge number of papers devoted to this number because many people, including very strong people, calculated separately the charge of the kink and separately, the mass of the kink and separately its central charge, and the results were alternating. So there was no coincidence, although the kink was saturated and protected. So the emergence of this anomaly solved the problem. And then a little later, maybe a couple of years later, I also discovered in super Young-Mills theory, without matter, there is a similar anomaly which was overlooked for many years, namely the brain charge. We used to call it very simplistically a central charge, which as Natia noted is not quite correct name. The naming is a little bit misleading because it's not fully central charge. It is not Lorentz invariant. It has this structure, Lorentz structure, which is proportional to the area of the domain wall appearing in this theory. But the constant in front of it is protected indeed. It is a scalar constant, and it is equal to the difference between the gluon condensate in two distinct vacua. In such theories, in SUN theories, there are n distinct vacua. And if you take each lambda squared Gaugian condensate is the order parameter, which takes n distinct values. If you take the difference between these values in the vacua initial and final, then you find the central charge. The central charge exactly determines the tension of the model. What is interesting for the neighboring vacua, the tension of the model scales like n, not like n squared, which is would be typical for solitons. And Edward Wheaton immediately figured out that this wall is in fact analogous to the brain in string theory. Okay, one more. I have very few minutes. One more remark, which is also the work, it's already 2,000 years. It's a very simple observation which we made, Adi Armoni, Veneziano, Gabriele Veneziano and myself, we made a extremely simple but useful observation. I believe it was the first time ever when supersymmetry could be related to phenomenology. Here you see the Lagrangian of pure super Young-Mills, n equal 1. You have gluons, you have gluina. Gluina is a Majorana or Weyl fermion in the joint representation. Now we realize that if you replace this Weyl adjoint by Dirac in the two-index symmetric or anti-symmetric representation, then these two theories are completely equivalent at Lagian. This is called the planar equivalence. And in particular, condensates, gluina condensates, which are exactly known in super Young-Mills, should have their analogs in the condensates, in the Dirac condensates of these Dirac particles in the planar daughters. Now, what is also a simple observation, then n is not infinitely large, but equal to 3, this anti-symmetric Dirac spinner becomes just a quark. So if you believe that n equal 3 is not that far from n equal infinity, you can predict the quark condensate in QCD with one flavor through the exact result in supersymmetry. And we return to this determination. We did it several times, one with pure theoretical chiral symmetry result. And recently, there were very precise lattice results for one flavor QCD, and we compared supersymmetry-based calculation on with 1/n correction, which is not exact, of course, compared with these lattice results, and we obtained remarkable agreement. Okay, now I come in the remaining maybe 5 minutes, which I still have, I come to very recent developments. And these recent developments refer to the so-called non-abelian vortex strings. But I start with the first example, which has been already mentioned by Nati Zyberg. The first vortex string was discovered by Alexey Abrikosov back in 1954. And it appears in the Cooper, in the superconducting medium. If you have a Cooper pair condensate, and then you put a very long magnet with the south pole here and the north pole here, the magnetic field cannot be dispersed in the superconducting medium. This is the Meissner law. But the magnetic flux is conserved, so it has to be somehow transferred from here to here, and dynamically beneficial advantageous configuration when it is squeezed in a tube, flux tube, or vortex string, or a fixed transverse dimension, which is equal to the inverse size of the Higgs photon field. In this case, Abrikosov also invented superconductor of the second type. If you look at the Abrikosov string from a long distance, go far away and look at it, you don't see the internal structure of the string. All you see this fluctuating line or string, which has zero size, and then generalizes. It is characterized only by transverse coordinates, which in the covariant gauge will be 4 coordinates. So we say that it is a string in 4 dimensions. If you try to generalize it using the Nambu-Gatow action, then you come to string theory. Of course, it can be consistently quantized only in 10 dimensions and only after supersymmetrization. Now let's go further. This slide shows one of the persons show is right here. This was an absolutely breakthrough development which opened many new horizons, or better to say many new roads. It was the first ever demonstration in the analytic terms without using computers of the dual Meissner effect, which was conjectured in the 1970s. So, in this sense, it was really mobilizing development because, or inspiring development, if you wish, because of at least we got some qualitative understanding of what goes on in the problem of confinement. The string which they proved to appear is, in fact, it's a Abrikosov string of the abelian type. So it's non-critical in 4 dimensions. Now, let me say a few words of quite recent developments, which mainly are due to the beginning was set by Hanani and Tong, an Italian group, Auzze, and others, and then by Jung and myself. It was 2003, and since then we still continue working on that. Now, you don't have to have a 4-dimensional string if you find the vortex string solution supported in, let's say, supersymmetric field theories. For instance, this example shows you if you take 4-dimensional bulk Young-Mills theory with n equal to supersymmetry and with the number of flavors equal to the number of colors, you get a different string. Here the graphic representation of the result. Here you have a string-like vortex solution. But in addition to geometrical coordinates, 4 geometrical coordinates, at every point of this string, there lives 2 other massless excitations, the so-called moduli. They live in the internal space, which can be called isotopic. And in fact, their low energy theory is described by, in this particular case, simple SO2 case, but CP1 n equal to sigma model. what is sigma model? You have a unit vector, its endpoints slide over the surface of a two-dimensional sphere. So it represents two extra dimensions, but these extra dimensions are compactified on a two-dimensional sphere. So you can say this is a six-dimensional string with two dimensions compactified and four dimensions flat. In this particular case, what we get on the string world sheet, okay, geometrical part is trivial, but dynamics of this additional moduli is non-trivial. They are kind of non-abelian. They form a sigma model which has asymptotic freedom. In this sense, it becomes very strong in the infrared. It would be impossible, it would be hard to move further, except that many strongly coupled to dimensional theories are solved in this or that way. This model was exactly solved by the Zamolochikov brothers in 1973, I believe, or maybe 74. So we know full description of this model. One thing which I want to point out here is that here we have complete match between four dimensions and two dimensions. This is the running of the gauge coupling in the bulk four-dimensional theory. You see it runs. The theory is not conformal. And then you continue. At a certain point, it stops running in four dimensions, but this two-dimensional coupling constant picks up, and it exhibits in two dimensions now, but the same curve. You see, you would never, if you measure them separately and draw on the same plot, you would never believe that from four dimensions you jumped into two dimensions. This is a hint that something interesting happens here. Okay, this is already I explained. So I can go to another slide. Here I show you an extremely interesting phenomenon which we discovered, and we called it 2D correspondence. You see, this correspondence with the running coupling extends much, much further. For instance, in the CP1 model, we know from Witten that there are two degenerate vacua, and if there are two degenerate vacua, there can be a solution where you have one vacua on the right of the string, another on the left with the transition domain in between. This transition domain is also BPS protected, and it's called a kink. It's a particle-like configuration in the CP1 model. At strong coupling, its mass is not calculable by through perturbation theory, but it's known from the exact solution of the CP1 model. Okay, it depends on the ratio of twisted mass in this model to the gauge scale parameter lambda. And you understand, because of the gauge coupling matching, that lambda, gauge parameter, scale parameter in two and four dimensions are identical. So the statement is that this kink, which is easily obtained from exact two-dimensional solution of a two-dimensional model, in fact, from generalizations of Zamolochikov, has a relative in four dimension, which has exactly the same dependence for the same mass formula. And this relative is nothing else as the monopole. How do we know that the monopole is the relative of our kink? Four-dimensional monopole is a relative to our two-dimensional kink. To this end, we can start. There are two parameters in the model, essential psi, which I didn't mention, it's Faye-Leopold term, but it's unimportant, and the quark masses, delta m. If you set psi equal to zero in the four dimensions, you have, and delta m large in the four dimensions, you have just a standard Hof-Polyakov monopole. Everybody knows, right, this monopole, the magnetic lines are radially directed and equidistant. Now we will start including psi, keeping psi equal to zero, but Well, xi is not equal. Making small xi, keeping delta m very large, what we see is this xi enforces the quark, its quark condensation in the bulk, so the magnetic lines get trapped. And as we make psi larger and larger, they're trapped stronger and stronger. So when we come to delta m tending to zero, which is the same as psi very large, then you see thin strings and a kink attached to them. And the mass formula for the monopole, which is also fortunately exactly known from this beautiful Zyberg-Witten solution, matches the mass formula one-to-one for the two-dimensional kink solution, okay? So it was a remarkable finding for us. And now, I don't know, would you give me 2-3 minutes? Now I'm coming to a more remarkable finding, which I would only describe very briefly. So what we discovered quite recently, you see the previous string which I discussed was, for the case of SU2, it was six-dimensional string with extra dimensions compactified on the sphere. It was not conformal. It was not UV complete. It was very useful, let's say, for 2D, 4D correspondence, but it was we couldn't compare it with the honest-to-God classical string theory. And now, recently, we came up with another finding, the same n equal 2 theory, four-dimensional bulk theory. I mentioned the free parameter, the number of flavors. Previously, for many years, we were considering an f equal to n. Now, we decided to change n, and we took an f equal to 2n. Now, with an f equal to 2n, you have, of course, more degrees of freedom, extra degrees of freedom on the wall sheet of the vortex string, because in addition to rotational moduli, you get orientation moduli. Altogether, one can show that you get six extra degrees of freedom, not two, like previously, by six, if an f is equal to 2n. The theory in the bulk is conformal, modulo this Fayet-Leopoldus term, which doesn't run anyway. And, hold your breath, the theory on the string wall sheet turns out to also be conformal. Its beta function exactly vanishes. This is this theory. It's called in physical literature weighted CP2,2 model. Sorry. In mathematical, it has a name in mathematical literature which I can never pronounce. And the target space of this extra modula is in fact a non-compact Calabi-Yau manifold, which is Ricci flat. So altogether, we have 10-dimensional string, which is quote-unquote compactified on six-dimensional Ricci flat manifold. It's not honest to God compactification because it is non-compact Calabi-Yau. And one can see that the total Virasoro central charge for this string exactly vanishes. It vanishes only if nf is equal to 2n and if we have four geometrical dimensions. So it's kind of a reverse idea because we don't start with 10-dimensional abstract space-time and then try to find what happens if we reduce it somehow to four dimensions. We start with honest-to-God gauge theory in four dimensions, which is well-known, exactly solvable in a low-energy limit due to results of Zyberg and Beaton. So there are no anomalies, no tachyons, no bad phenomena whatsoever. We may be sure of that. And now we add six extra dimensions to this theory, which are formed by the moduli, extra moduli of the string, and altogether presents a critical string solution. So if it is a critical string, well, there is one more condition of criticality. Of course, it only can happen if the gauge coupling in the bulk is strong. In particular, we identify this coupling G squared in the bulk is equal to 4 pi. Now at this point we have a classic critical string called Byton non-compact Calabi-Yau, and people played with it, and you can now find, okay, this is a strong regime in the bulk. You cannot read off the spectrum from the bulk theory. But there is a dual description. There is this string theory description from which you can, using the known methods developed in this particular case by Kutasov, Wather, and Dow, you can find the spectrum of the string, and that's what we did. And I am finishing. We found, we found that there is no massless spin 2 state, which is already good, because in our gauge theory, there is no place for massless spin 2, four dimensional theory, no place for massless spin 2. But massless scalars, four-dimensional scalars exist. There is their mass formula. L is arbitrary integer parameter. You see, if L equal to zero, you have a massless scalar spin zero state, which we know a priori, because in our original four-dimensional bulk Young-Mills theory, there are massless scalars. Now, for the massless spin 2 states, which are not present because the strong coupling only appear, this is the mass formula. L is again integer. You see that the lowest is mass is 2 pi t. T is the tension of the string. So I believe it's a very exciting development for me personally, because I'm a kind of down-to-earth person. It's hard for me to perceive very abstract notion, but now I'm starting understanding this language, what's going on, you know, when people develop string theory, because each time I translate in my head onto this picture with a solitonic vortex string. And that's finally, I'm sorry for over time, this is my conclusion. The first conclusion is that 10-dimensional critic string is reincarnation of a BPS soliton in 4D n equal 2 super Young-Mills with the U2 group and 4 flavors. In a sense, this is a reverse holography. Usually you start from higher dimensional space, and what you want to study is what happens at its boundary. Now it's totally opposite formulation of the problem. You start from the four-dimensional boundary and build auxiliary six auxiliary dimension to build your state from which you can look at this. Well, and I will repeat the general conclusion that supersymmetry completely changed the quantum field theory at strong coupling in particular. Previously, besides beyond two dimensions, there were no methods of dealing with strong coupling. Now we are building one after another more and more methods. And I'm very optimistic in this, so I conclude my talk that I expect more successes on this road. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Misha. It was a very interesting talk. Questions? I have a quick question myself. So you chose nf equals to 2n. Any particular reason? I mean, why is 2n so unique? I mean, so special?
Because you see, you have an equation for the Rasoro central charge, and this equation is in integers. So you have to make sure that the Virasoro central charge, including ghosts, vanishes for the criticality of the string. And the second condition, which is in a part related to it, that the theory on the string will shift, must be conformal. Conformality of the string fixes you that nf equal to 2n, and the Virasoro central charges fixes you that n is equal to 2. So there is a unique four-dimensional Young-Mills theory, which under certain condition becomes a critical string and can be treated, therefore, at strong coupling.
Okay, thank you. Just one comment while Cathy can finish to prepare. I have another question. I read at some point that you claim that supersymmetry is the greatest discovery in Soviet Union after the Second World War.
Yes, I would say so. But you know what, just to wind up with another remark, the scientific fate of both Goldfund and Tichman, it was quite tragic. None of them survived. Goldfund himself, 2 years after the discovery of supersymmetry, he was fired from his institute, which is Lebedev Physics Institute, as the most unproductive theorist in this institute. And then he was blacklisted and couldn't find any job for a relatively large time. And then, being fired and with no job, he decided to immigrate to Israel, which completely finished him and both his graduate student, Lichtman. So none of them really could continue in physics.
And you also claim that supersymmetry will dominate the 21st century in the same way that special and general relativity dominated the 20th century.
I hope so.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I hoped it would happen faster. It did. It's still not discovered so far. But I was not the only one. Nati, who made a lot of work in superstring theory, used to say in the past that this would be a great support for discovery of superpartners, would be a great support, and I fully agree this would be, but unfortunately it didn't happen. But I hope that it will. In this sense, I am an optimist.
Great. Okay. Thank you very much, Misha, and let's thank Misha again for the great talk and the medal. So now the grand finale. So it's again a pleasure for me to call Professor Arkady Weinstein to come and receive the Dirac Medal. Arkady will give the last presentation of the ceremony.
Okay. Of course, I'm honored to be in such a distinguished company. And thank you very much. But I will try to put my acknowledgement at the end of the talk. I mean, more detailed acknowledgement. So I will start with first with some kind of personal recollections. That my first visit to the West was in 1979, and it was to the International Center, ICTP, and it happened in the end of November of 79. I came for a month's visit here, and I said it was my first travel to the West. Abdul Salam kept his invitation during 3 years. Okay, and for some sheer luck, I was allowed by Soviet authorities to go out. My impression is that it was just they didn't fulfill the plan of travel, because December is not the month people would travel, right? But I was there. So I met Abdul Salam here, and he was preparing to leave for Sagon ceremony. It was a year he got a Nobel Prize. So he was in extremely good mood and talked about, this distinguished Russian physicist who did not get a Nobel Prize while he believes that they deserve it. Okay, so, I don't know, because it was my first trip to the West. I mean, it was extremely strong, it produced extremely strong impression on me. And I remember it's very lively until today. And I was thinking, I was living at the end of December. It was after Christmas, so I believe December 28. And what happened that day, you probably do not remember, but it was the day when Soviet troops entered Afghanistan. So, yeah, so it was this particular day. Sorry? Here. Ah, no, this should work. It doesn't? Okay. Just here. Uh-huh. Thank you. I'm trying to be closer to you. I will try to present. Okay, maybe because I'm too old, I'm trying to present mostly old stuff, and it is kind of a few examples of uses of Wilson operator product expansion. But it was kind of global idea for us during all this period, so that's why I think that, it's interesting to follow. So let me start from reminding you about this Wilson procedure of operator product expansion. No, people discuss this kind of stuff even before him, and particularly I remember when I was a student, it was, say, Pokrovsky, Potashinsky in Novosibirsk who did this kind of implication to phase transition. They did not formulate it in a proper way, but it was kind of very interesting development. Okay, but let's say that we have this some local Lagrangian, and I couldn't find it. Too far? Okay, here it is. Index M here, it implies that its Lagrangian is supplied by a regulator. M, it is an ultraviolet regulator, so it means that we are limiting integration over virtual moment up by M. Okay, so then let's say that we have an observable amplitude, which could be represented as some certain path integral of this exponent with this Lagrangian. We will view this local Lagrangian and some of our local operators might out of the field. So C, I is coefficient, O is operator might out of the field. Let's change our ultraviolet cutoff to a lower one. So we're going to from M to M tilde, which is smaller one, and define a new Lagrangian, defined with this M tilde, and the condition is that low energy amplitude are the same. So you have original Lagrangian to calculate amplitude, and you have this new one, M tilde, and you're getting the same amplitude. Okay, so that fixed for us what would be a new coefficient in this tilde Lagrangian. So. And it was very clear representation, of the procedure. To show if you look at this kind of classical textbook on in the literature, you would think that people always talk about proving operator product expansion. But you see, in the recent approach, there is no need to prove anything because it's done by construction. You started from local Lagrangian, you get in local Lagrangian. So in this way, this original derivation of people in quantum electrodynamics when they proved that everything could be done by finite number of count atoms, it's automatic in this procedure. The difference is that how many local operators you should have to consider. So once you see that it's enough to limit yourself by dimension equal 4, then you are done. Of course, but operator product expansion constructed by Wilson could be applied not only for normalizable theory, but for normalizable as well. There, number of coefficient, number of operators could grow. Okay. So this... A few applications of operatable expansion. It was mostly what we did together with Valia Zakharov and Misha Schiffman. The first one, when we started, in 1973, and it was an application, a song interaction application to weak non-leptonic amplitude. So, no, I mean, to remind you that what was the, this problem was, the problem was that you have this decay of Kn to pi plus pi minus, and for neutral one, and you have for charge one, also decay into pi, and the ratio of the width, it is 450. So for the amplitude, it is like one over 20, I mean, a ratio in favor of this delta I equal 1/2 transition versus delta I equals 3/2. So here it is only either spin 0, I mean, mostly either spin 0, and here it is a spin only 2. So that's why it is this one. So, and it is pure song interaction effect because, I mean, if you look at original Lagrangian, there is no number 20 for the ratio of amplitude. Already Ken Wilson, when, in his 1969 paper, suggested that it could be some enhancement at short distances in favor of delta I equal 1/2. However, it was difficult to test it because QCD was not there yet, and it was not clear whether it's possible to realize in the theory. Then what happened next, that QCD did appear, and people, you know, of course, tried to use this idea to check it. Particularly, it was Mary Kay Gaillard with Vivian Lee in one paper, and another paper was by Guido Altarelli and Luciano Maiani, and they did this QCD calculation as function of distances in application to non-leptonic amplitude, and they got this logarithmic corrections, like a power of the log of MW or lambda QCD, and they and indeed, delta I equal 1/2 was enhanced. However, log is not such a large number, so numerically they fell short to explain, I mean, this ratio. So what we noticed, in addition to what they did, that there are heavy quark loops. And it was kind of notion at that time that this famous gym mechanism, Glashow plus Maiani, between different quarks, particularly I have in mind, say, let's say that forget about T and B quark for the moment, just C quark, additional one. So that it would be this smallness. And if mu is like MW, then it's kind of small effect. What we notice that it is not this ratio, it is logarithmic stuff. And when MC is large, then it's not a suppression anymore. And it is what we used, okay? So, and it leads to a new type operator involving right-handed quarks. So it is the diagram which we wrote in our paper 1975, okay? In 77, it was rewritten this way, redrawn this way by John Ellis. I don't know, you maybe heard the story that he had a bet that he will put penguin in his next paper. So you see, here it is him. Okay, so they did it for big work physics. But the idea was the same, and it's kind of this name stick six, so it's called penguin mechanism. Okay. Now, so here it is example. It is operator containing right-handed work. You see, it is left-handed card multiplied by right-handed card. If you do Fitts transformation, you will put left and right in the same stuff, and then you will get matrix elements like this one. Okay, and this matrix element, you can see, contains m pi square over mu plus md. And m pi square over mu plus md, it's numerically 2GV, which is a relatively large scale compared with, say, f pi, which is, say, 100 MeV. But even if you take mass of rho, it is still smaller than this. So this gives you enhancement of matrix element. And we use this enhancement to explain this one. Let me say that, okay, C-quark mass occurs to be not that much large you can get calculation of this for this new operator reliably. So we fit practically all decays, but we use a phenomenological value of coefficient for the of 5 or 6. So you're going to the range where physics in terms of quarks and physics in terms of hadrons are kind of overlapping too much. So, say, Bill Bardeen and Jay Buller, they try to do this kind of in terms of quarks later on. Okay, so, our next idea with the operator product was to apply it to the product of two current. It could be electromagnetic current, or it could be some other current made out of quarks, some quark current. And here it is what we see. It is in the framework of the same procedure. You can say that product of current, it is sum over some local operators. And we are trying to have matrix element over vacuum. So it's non-perturbative feature of the vacuum to study. And if you're making a vacuum, then only spin zero operator will contribute because, I mean, of the vacuum. So we can limit ourselves only spin zero operator, so this structure is fixed. And so here you have just function, coefficient which depends on Q squared. Q squared is Euclidean. So we are going to Euclidean range in momenta, okay? So what are those operators? The lowest dimension, it is identity operator. And coefficient for this operator would be normal perturbation theory for polarization operator. So it's not new, it's known up to some number of loops. Okay, what the next? The next one, it is dimension 4 operator, which is a product of gluonic field strength. Okay, you can check that if, say, we neglect mass of quarks, it's the only operator, which would be dimension 4. Okay, of course, there are operators of dimension 6 such as four fermionic operator, which we also could be considered. Okay, so coefficient for this operator by dimension round, of course, should be 1 over Q to the fourth, but it also logarithmic dependence contains logarithmic dependence because alpha s, it is 1 over log. So when you take vacuum average, then we have this new stuff, which is called gluon condensate, and which gives you power corrections 1 over Q to the fourth to perturbation theory. Okay, so we do not have tools to calculate a quark condensate itself. We took it phenomenologically. While it was some models, for example, Savidi and Matinian suggested structure of the vacuum made out of vertices, similar to what Misha discussed. Not clear how reliable you can do this. But for us, what is important is separation of distance, that we can factorize out short distances, which we put in coefficient, and large distances, which we went to non-perturbative matrix element. Here it is a diagram to illustrate it. So you have large momenta going over quark, and let's say and this dashed line and this gluon, and let's say that K is much smaller than Q. So then you can contract everything and say that it is kind of this small momenta K loop. But of course, it's non-perturbative because K is in the range of small momenta, right? So we don't calculate, but it is an imitation of this gluon condensate. Okay. So then, having this, for example, we can use dispersion relation, applying certain procedure instead of dispersion denominator, you can have exponent, and then you have this integral from spectral function, and you can put it in this form that here it is observable spectral function in polarization operator in terms of Hadron, here it is photonic. Imaginary part, it is the way to calculate the diagram. So these first two terms, it is identity operator, coefficient for identity operator. This additional term, 1 over m to the fourth, which we can calculate this way, and plus corrections from 1 over m to the sixth as well. Okay, and then using this, we can now try to fit experimental parameter, like, say, for example, you put in imaginary part the spectral function as a combination of delta function resonance plus the cut. So we have mass of resonance, residue of resonance, and, say, position of the cut, three parameters. Then we can, from this, define all three parameters. And it was prediction which worked in many cases very well. So quite a number, okay. Now, I believe that it is my third, last example of this operator expansion. We had actually more example of this kind, particularly the one which I'm missing to present. It is about heavy quark expansion in the mass of heavy quark, like a heavy quark effective theory. It's an application to, say, B physics, say, where you consider B mass and decays. But here I'm trying to talk about this Wilsonian action in application to supersymmetric series. And subtlety, I'm trying to emphasize, is that Feynman rules, when we are writing diagram, it's not Feynman rules for coefficient. Because remember, each time we are going all the way down to compare a new Lagrangian with the original one. So it's like two independent Feynman calculation, and it doesn't matter what is which way we regularize infrared. What is important is that we do this matching. And supersymmetry represent as a case where it's very this distinguishing of scale is very important. So here we can talk about, for example, effective action, which so-called generator of one on loop of one particle reducible vertices in the standard diagram, if you like, with certain type of infrared regularization. On the other hand, we have a Wilson action, and in Wilson action, we are not including momenta lower than something. So what does it mean? It means that this gamma is a kind of metric segment over Wilson action over a range of momenta below mu. Okay, to see that why it's important. Let's turn to this beta function and SVZ beta function, which Misha already mentioned. Here it is written in more or less in the same form. Original derivation was based on instanton calculus, as Misha discussed, but it was clear that the result is perturbative, so it should be understood in perturbative way as well. So, and it is what we try to do. So let's say that we have this action of non-abelian Yang-Mills theory. We have this chiral term, which is integral over d2 theta, and we have this meta term, which is integral over full superspace. Okay. What is specific for this term? That it is similar to superpotential. Remember, Misha mentioned that there is a non-minimization theorem of superpotential. This term is also chiral, but G square is running. So what is special? The special is that you can prove that in certain sense, you would expect that running of this one over G square should be limited by one loop. One way to see it is holomorphy, because you can make it a complex one over G square, and the only way then to change one over G square is to add the kind of log of ultraviolet. That's it. You cannot have higher loops. Okay. And we are saying that Wilson action has this feature for forever. So in Wilson action, this term would be normalized only at the level of one loop. Okay, not in contradiction with the existence of higher loops, of course, because we have to take matrix element. Okay, so here it is this expression in one loop. One over G square is equal, it is correction to vector field, and it is correction due to meta field, okay? But you see what's going on, that here we have this correction, and then we need to take matrix element on both terms, this one and this one. This one looks like, by equation of motion, is like a zero. But you need to legalize it to see that matrix element of this term is not zero. And what happened from this term, that when you take matrix element, you are changing, you introduce a regulator, and effectively change the regulator to regulator divided by z. Okay, so this matter term changes this way. You can check that 1 over g squared, w squared term, matrix element, it is, you can view it in such a way that it's matter, vector fields are, they are matter for themselves, right? Because they are charged, you can say, take, say, neutral one and the other charge, right? So, but z factor for those fields is given by the same 1 over g square, which was coefficient. So here it is, correction would be log of g square. Okay, and then you can check that if you count for this matrix element, then you are back to this beta function, which was discussed, was written before. So holomorphicity is preserved for 1 over g square, term for the chiral term. And also it explain this long-standing puzzle was formulated in 1976 by Ferrara and Zumina, that if you consider, say, T to mu mu, trace of energy momentum tensor, it contains full beta function. If you consider the divergence of the axial current in pure supersymmetric mills, then it is kind of Bardeen theorem, that there is no higher loops of beta function. How you can, and they should be in the same multiplet, so it should be the same coefficient for both. Now, when we are saying that in Wilson form, it is one loop everywhere for d mu and mu and for t to mu mu, but it's a Pareto equant. So you have right hand side, which is one loop beta function multiplied by w square. Then, when you are taking matrix element, you are getting full beta function as a result of this taking matrix element. Okay. Now, I'm coming to my acknowledgement, so I believe I'm more or less on time, right? As I wrote Fernando Acueda, that I am extremely honored to be a recipient of Dirac Medal from Abdul Salam International Center for Theoretical Physics, and of course I'm also honored to share this award with Nati Zayberg. I always admire his non-stop production of novel breakthrough. Even now he is doing this, right? you see, okay. Okay, so and with Mr. Schiffman, who is my dear friend and collaborator for about 44 years. When I look recently in this Spires citation, it marks 115 papers together. Okay, so, I should say that, frankly speaking, I'm somewhat embarrassed that I'm not sharing this honor with Vali Zakharov, who led us for many years, and he is a person who has this, I don't know how to describe it, but I did try to put it as having says, his gut feelings, what is important to do in physics. Not that formal, but senior, so I only can say thank you, Vale, now. Okay, and I tried to do it to this, that I indebted to my advisors and also co-authors, Viktor Garitsky and Wallis Yoffe. I mark those who are not with us anymore in black. Okay, probably not many of you know Viktor Garitsky, but if somebody saw this collection of quantum mechanics problem, it's recently was printed in a larger version by his grandson, who is also Viktor Garitsky. Okay, and also Gersh Butker, who was our director in Novosibirsk Institute, which now has his name, and Vladimir Gribov. I view them as my teachers as well. So I'm thankful to my collaborators. Sorry for the list, but it is kind of, I mean, I indeed feel myself that I need to produce things. Yuli Kliplovich, Vali Sokolov, Sasha Dolgov, Alexei Kaidalov, Viktor Novikov, Misha Voloshin, Zhenya Bogomolny, Larry McLaren, Alexei Jung, Sasha Gorsky, Andrei Smilga, Adam Ritz, Roman Cviki, Andrei Losev, Nikolai Uraltsev, Ikar Zbigi, Lev Koirach, Boris Blok, Andrei Grozin, Kirill Melnikov, Andrzej Chernetsky, Bill Marciano, Ksim Amrades, and Eduardo Di Rafael. And I'm trying to finish it with my heartfelt thanks to my wife, Nelly, who is here, and to my daughters, Tanya, whose birthday right now. I mean, but not this year. and the other one, Anna. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael. Very nice talk. Questions? Mr. Could you remind us, you were talking about the difference between the Wilsonian and the 1 pi action,
yeah,
and about the holomorphicity of the gauge coupling. Can you remind us the case when the gauge coupling was field dependent and this Karponosky et al. Calculation, they found some...
Yeah. Yes. You remember this?
Yes.
With Misha, we discussed this because it was also example of similar kind where you need to separate out what is kind of chiral tones, which are not Riemannized or Riemannized at maximum at one loop, and those which are non-chiral. And they found example where it was at the level of one loop, not at the level of two loop, but the idea is the same.
But essentially they found, so there was an issue there, right? Because the calculation give you holomorphic.
No, but in this way you can say that high loops give you, holomorphic anomaly, right? Because they appear. And they just happen earlier, but it is also because it is formed like Z factors, which are not protected.
Okay.
So the reason was similar.
Okay, very good. More questions? So to finish with an anecdote, can you remind us the origin of the name Penguin Diagram? Could you remind us the origin of the name Penguin Diagram?
Origin?
Yes.
No,
why were they called Penguin?
Because he, I believe, had a bed with... You may remember it was some experimental physicist, a woman, I forgot her name. She was in at CERN. Sorry? No. But I mean, the bed was not with Ruder. Collaborators were Mary Kay Gayari and Ruder indeed. But The bed was with this experimentalist who was there. They were just in the bar, and he lost the bet. They put play the game of dart, and he lost to her. He was very good in dart. John. So he lost to her, and the one who lost the game, he promised that he put penguin into his next paper. And it happened to be his next paper. So he had no way out. So he uses the diagram to put a penguin inside. No, it is according to his own recollection. So he actually even mentioned that he was using some substance. Illegal substance. Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Arkady. So let's thank Arkady again. Congratulations again for the Dirac Medal. So this is not the end, because we have a couple of things to announce. Probably you knew, but all this has been live streaming, so in that sense, and of course it will be recorded, so you can always have this as a memory. I think it's a very special event, so it was good to record it. Now there will be outside some refreshments for everybody, but not for the awardees yet, because there will be a photo session, I think, with them. So I hope the photographer... Oops, where's the photographer? Oh, yes. He will be prepared to start to take some photos. And also, we, as a tradition, we have here at ICTP... That after each colloquium, we invite the ICTP diploma students to come down and have an opportunity to chat with the speakers. So I think this we can do it in a very informal way. So then the message is that essentially everybody can go out to have some refreshments. We will have the photo session, and in the meantime, the diploma students can come down and have a short chat with the awardees. So having said that, so let's congratulate again to Nati, to Misha, and to Arkady.